was privileged to knock on a door in West Tampa, and a young guy, 12 years old, came to the door, and we looked eye to eye. His name was Russ, and he started coming to Sunday school, and he gave his heart to Jesus. Now we don't look eye to eye anymore, but I look up to him. I appreciate him and his love for the Lord.
Amen.
And God bless you all.
Good morning, y'all.
Good morning.
Is this thing, you still hear me? I first visited this church about 1978. And I can still remember you guys used to have a thing, I think, called Dinner in the Grounds.
Yes.
I remember. Being a always hungry young teenager and filling up on fried chicken and all the fixings. I was here to visit because I was with my sort of adopted big brother, Kent. And he was here because he had his eye on a pretty young lady named Becky. And the book is still being written on that courtship. But I think it's fair to say that Pastor still has his approving eye on Kent all these years later. I would like to share my testimony with you, and I'd like to do that today in light of Philippians 1:6. Being confident of this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
With emphasis this morning on he, God, is who begins it, and it is he, God, the one who will perform it or complete it. For me, as Kenna just alluded to and Pastor did, for me, the it began when I was 12. And I was living over in town and country, and I was over at a friend's house. And we heard a knock at the door. And my friends peek into the window, and you see maybe it was a J. Dubs or somebody didn't look right. So he said, "Oh, you get it." So I said, "All right." And I went to open the door, and he hid behind the door, and he's like giggling. And the man at the door invited me to, said he drove a Sunday school bus and invited me to come with him, and would I like to come on Sunday? And my friends is like, "Wait for me to tell the guy off." And I says, "Yes, I'd like to go." My friend just looked at me like, "What?" Closed the door, said goodbye, and made arrangements to come on Sunday. And my friend said, "You really going to go?" I said, "Yeah." I didn't know why at the time. I honestly didn't. I went on Sunday, and I kept going. And after a few months, I put my faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, Amen. Became my Savior. And, but what, you know what the problem is? I've gotten old and I can't even read my own chicken scratch. That's better. But why did I say yes to that man at the door? The 12-year-old goof around with his friends, the stage was set for me to say, yeah, no thanks, and close the door and laugh with my friend. I had no idea back then. But then having grown a little bit, I hear the word of our Lord in John 10:27. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, yes. And they follow me. And so, he began a good work in me 45 years ago and is performing it today. And what I've come to understand and wish to share and encourage you with this morning is that it's all about him. He is good. He is true. Amen. He is faithful, even when we are not.
Amen.
And being all about him is what our life is supposed to be. He is at work transforming us into the image of his son. You see, God is still at work with me. But hear this. God's word is true. My life testifies to that. Through sickness and great loss in these recent times, through periods of great rebellion and sin, I'm still here. I'm actually standing here behind pastor's pulpit sharing with you the greatness and awesomeness of God 45 years later. But that has nothing to do with me. It's all about Him. He is good. He is true. He is faithful. May we truly thank Him for His amazing grace. May the desire of our hearts be to be more like Jesus. And the very essence and purpose of our lives be Him. I thank our Lord for raising up faithful men of God for Himself. I thank the Lord for you, Pastor. To think that He's been here almost as long as I've been alive gives me chills. It's glory to our God. That man who knocked on the door was 45 years ago. This man I will always love. I will always be especially thankful for. It was him who taught me to be a man, taught me to be a man of God. But I'm sure if you ask either one of these men, they'll tell you the same thing. It wasn't about them. Amen. It was about Him. Yeah. Thank you for hearing this morning.
Thanks for that good testimony, brother. Thank you for being with us. Y'all be seated. God bless you. Thank you very much.
We thank God for people who do not mind standing up and testifying how they got saved, and people that God brought into their life. That means so much. It really does. We appreciate Brother Russ, appreciate Brother Ken, and we're so glad that you're here today. We're thankful for the visitors and guests that have come in. We thank God for those who will be on video watching and observing these who sing and testify during this special time.
Marching on, marching on. truth is marching on. I have seen them in the watchfires of 100 circling camps. They have built within an altar when the evening news advance. I can read his righteous sentence behind the dim and flaring lamps. His day is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His blood is marching on. He has sounded forth the trumpet that shall never sound.
In God is all.
discussing, you were talking about birthdays. My birthday is tomorrow, July 4th. And so that's why everybody's wearing red, white, and blue today. Isn't that pretty neat? Not really, but thank the Lord for America. Amen. We've been focusing on America and what's made America great. Well, the thing that's made America great is because our trust in God, a true living God. We've held up the word of God. We've sent out missionaries all over the world for many, many years, over 100 years now. And I want to just share a testimony. This is not a health ministry's testimony necessarily, but just a testimony that I heard a number of years ago from a fellow from India. He is now pastoring over there, but he got trained here at Landmark Baptist College. When he came as a student, he told the story about it. When he came as a student there, they put him with a family in the church. And so he went to this family in the church. He'd never been to America before, and he was really blown away by everything this family had. First of all, I took him to his bedroom, and it had a big, beautiful, cushy bed, and which he couldn't sleep in. It was too soft. He ended up sleeping on the floor starting out, and because he was used to sleeping on mats on the floor, and he couldn't handle the soft beds. But then they showed him around the place and beautiful home they had, and all this nice flowers and all kinds of greenery. They took him out to this big barn in the back. And the man that had the place, he said, I just wanted to show you some of the things we have out here. And they had a tractor and a riding lawnmower and weed eaters. And up by the top of the barn were about six or seven bicycles just hanging there. And he thought, man, he says, people in our country would just love to have one bicycle and can't hardly afford it. And this guy's got seven bicycles and doesn't even ride them hardly at all. And he has all this stuff. And so he went home. He went back to his room. And that night he laid on the floor. And he would kind of get a bad attitude about everything. He says, why does America have all the money? Why does America have everything? We're the wealthiest country in the world. Everybody wants to come to America and nobody wants to leave. Isn't that amazing? And there's something about this country. But then he got thinking about that and he says, you know, what would have happened if God gave all the money to India? He says, they would have sent missionaries out to make everybody Hindus. What if God had given all the money to China or Russia? They'd have sent all their missionaries out and made everybody communist. And he said, what if God had given all the money to Burma? They'd have sent missionaries out, made everybody Buddhist. He says, God gave the money to America because they're sending out the gospel of Jesus Christ, which changes lives all over the world. Amen. And there are Christians in every country of the world today as a result of that. And very quickly, he got over his bad attitude. And he said, thank you, Lord, for America. Thank you for giving them the money and the heart for people to send missionaries around the world and to make a difference in people's lives. And he realized that he was a result of American missionaries going out. Well, now we work with national pastors around the world, 70 countries in the world, about 600 of them, helping them to raise a little support to go back to their countries, start churches and train national leadership and reach their countries for Christ. And they're doing a wonderful job of that. And I thank the Lord for this church particularly because this is called home when they're here. Amen. And you folks, when they're here, you folks just start giving all kinds of food, more than they could possibly eat. And they really enjoy it and enjoy the accommodations and your love for them is just endless. And we thank the Lord for that. And I'd just like to sing a couple of songs today. One is a song about America. It's called Repent America. And that's our need. You know, we don't like people coming in trash in America when they come here. But we need to tell the truth about our own country. Amen. And we do have needs in this country. Thank God for America. Thank God for what we're doing around the world in missions and helping other countries. And we have needs in America as well, spiritual needs. And we have a need for revival. And then I want to follow up with a song by, it was written by a Burmese man, one of our national pastors from Burma, who died just about a year or so ago with COVID, had a real struggle with it, real problem with it. But he left behind a number of songs that he had written. And I wrote the music, he wrote the words, and I want to share that song with you as well. It's his testimony of serving the Lord for all his life. We only have this life to live. We need to make it count for Christ. Amen?
God's given me but got one life to live. I surrender to His way. When I'm discouraged in the way, His hope and comfort comes. Christ is the rock on which I stand. He's more than enough. I'll seek my Lord for all my life. I will praise Him all my days. God's given me but one life to live. I'll surrender to His way. God's given me but one life to live. I'll surrender to His way.
It's been such a good service, full. We could say amen and go home and be blessed right now. And I feel limited for time, so I'm glad my father-in-law said I'm welcome to preach till 2 o'clock. Amen. He said everybody would leave at noon, but I'm welcome to preach till 2 o'clock. God bless you all, and what a good service this has been. It's been refreshing for me, and thank you. Thank you, Russ, for that testimony. Thank you, Brother Knickerbocker. And it's good to see a great member of Grace Baptist Church here today, Linda Ferguson. We miss her, and she's here at Fowler. It's good to see her. She was a blessing to our church. I'm sure she's a blessing here, and we're thankful. I hesitate to say this, but she was visiting a couple years ago, talking about her new neighborhood here in the Tampa Bay area, and she said, the problem with my neighborhood, and she's from New York, said there's too many New Yorkers there. I was shocked to hear her say that. I hope I didn't offend anyone just now. We love New Yorkers. We've been in New York for a long time now, and I'm thankful for meeting my wife here, and I'm so thankful for my in-laws. They're my favorite father and mother in favorite father-in-law and mother-in-law are right here in Tampa. Amen. And Becky's here, and we're planning to come down, but it just so happens she's able to be helping my mother-in-law today, and thankful for that. I sure miss her. She's always at church on Sunday, and it's rare for her not to be here, but it's such a privilege to be able to preach at a Fowler Avenue Baptist Church. And Amen. What a great country we have. What a wonderful country. Thank God for all the blessings America's enjoyed. There's a reason why thousands and thousands of people are coming to America every day. Many people risking their lives to come here. There's a reason for that. God has truly blessed our nation. And yet there are Christians that don't appreciate our nation. There are people that don't appreciate America. They criticize it. They say horrible things about it. And I know that we have weaknesses, we have problems, but thank the Lord today for America, for our nation. But thank God for that eternal country, heaven, that God has prepared for us. Yes. And we truly need revival. It's revival or it's removal for America. We need revival. And I'm the first to criticize the problems and the difficulties and the sorry low-down leadership we have nowadays in so many places. And I'm the first to criticize that, but what am I going to do about it? What are we going to do about it as born-again Christians, as Americans? Are we just going to criticize it? We're going to see the fall. We're just going to pour it out the air. But what are we going to do about it? And I believe today that really and truly that most of us believers have not given our all to God. We haven't reached our full potential for God. We're holding back. And America needs, and the church needs, our all. We need to be fully surrendered to our Lord. And we have the freedom to do that. Thank God for the freedom that we enjoy and for the liberty. And July 4th, 1776, 246 years ago, 56 brave men got together and signed the Declaration of Independence. History tells us they were signing their own death warrant. Because of it, many of them became poverty-stricken. Many were hurt and many were persecuted. But thank God for their vision, because they sought freedom before a holy God, and we enjoy that today. Yes. And there are powers and there are evildoers are trying to steal our very freedoms for that from us. And if you don't see that today, please wake up. Please see that. And we're losing freedoms right before our eyes, but we still have freedom.
Yes.
To go out and proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Turn with me, if you would, please, to John chapter 8. John chapter 8, looking here together at John chapter 8. I'm so thankful that the Lord has enabled us to be a part of the ministry, and what a privilege it is to be able to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Before I was full-time in the ministry,
God blessed us to be a member of a church here in the Tampa Bay area and have a bus ministry. And that's how I met my good friend Russ, and how I pray for him. He's been through such a difficult situation in the last recent year and a half or so. Just last week, we said goodbye to my daughter, my oldest daughter, Amanda. A lot of you know her. We have three daughters, all married to good Christian men. And something about an 18-year-old, 19-year-old young guy coming to your door, knocking on your door, wanting to date your daughter. What? I've raised them all these years, and you want to take them away? I'm glad that all three of them asked me for permission to date. I'm glad that all three of them, before they popped the question, for marriage, they asked me for permission to do that. And the first time it happened to me, it was uncharted waters. And this is a daughter that just moved recently to Georgia from New York. And my wife said, "Aren't you going to get back to Chris?" I said, "Well, I'm praying about it. I'm thinking about it." And 2 weeks went by, 2.5 weeks went by. My wife said, "It's been too long." I said, "Well, it's uncharted waters for me." And I found out later he was really sweating and everything. I didn't know you're supposed to get back within 24 hours, but I'm thankful for that. And it reminds me of years ago when I asked Becky to marry me at Lettuce Lake Park. What a romantic place. I didn't even know I was supposed to get on one knee. If I had it to do over, I'd get on a knee. I didn't get on a knee. I was sitting in a Chevy pickup, my brother's borrowed pickup, on Christmas Day, and I asked Becky to marry me. And you know what she said? She said, "You'll have to ask my father." And so we've been dating for over 5 years. Half that time I've been in New York and away at school. And so I went to the tuning compound, I call it, and we went there. And my kids used to think that was Florida. When you got in their yard, that was Florida. And we got there, and I asked my father-in-law to be. I didn't know if he would be or not. I said, "I'd like permission to marry Becky." And he thought for a moment. He cleared his throat. And he said, "You don't think you're rushing into things, do you?" I was very relieved at that question. So thank the Lord. And John chapter 8. As we consider the freedom that we enjoy in America, thank God for the freedom. I have not always appreciated it as I should have. But I'm so thankful today for the freedom that we have in Christ. And here in John chapter 8, in that 32nd verse, the Bible tells us, "And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." Mm-hmm. What people need, they need the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Right. And today, let's consider in the moments I have here, the subject of freedom. Freedom. Thank God that America is what it is because of the blessings of God, because people came to America to seek freedom, to seek God. Other countries were populated because people were seeking gold, but people came to America seeking God, and we've been blessed because of that. Thank God for churches like this that stand strong in an evil day for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Yes. Praise God for the privilege that we have to be free in Christ and to know the freedom that the Lord gives us. In verse 36, the Bible says, "If the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed." The freedom that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank God for the privilege we have to serve Him. And it's the greatest freedom of all, to know the Lord. As one orator in the years ago used to say, "Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, I'm free at last." He meant it different, I think, than I mean it. But I'm glad the day I got saved, I was free from my sin. Yes. I was free from the penalty of sin. Yes. Oh, the horror of hell. And God delivered me and every one of us that are born again here today from the horror of an everlasting hell, a place of undescribable torture and torment. If we could get a glimpse of hell, as some Christian workers have said, it would revolutionize our ministry. We would be so fervent to witness to people with our life, with our lips, with our literature. We would be on fire for God all the time because we would see the horror of hell. But we don't need an angel to open up the pit of hell for us to see it. We can see it in the Scripture. Jesus, who loved the world, warned of hell more than he did of the wonder of heaven, told of the wonder of heaven. Oh, thank God for the freedom that we have in Christ to escape the horror of hell. Thank God for the freedom we have in Christ to overcome the pull of sin. Do you have it in your life? I would think after being saved since a 9-year-old boy and hearing thousands of messages and reading the Bible and studying and being around great Christians and being indwelt by the Holy Spirit of God, there would be a point where
I wouldn't have that pull of sin, that temptation. But we all have it. We have that old sinful nature, don't we? And the devil's a reality. And I thank God that greater is he that's in us than he is in the world. And that old world system, oh, we love the beautiful creation. Brother Gerald was painting a beautiful picture about the millions of stars that God has placed in heaven in Sunday school. Oh, the creation that God has. We're not talking about that world that God's created, but the old world that's headed by the devil. 2 Corinthians 4:4, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ should shine unto them. We need to send a light, amen, around the world and here in the Tampa Bay area, everywhere we are, we need to send a light. And I thank the Lord today that we can have the freedom to overcome the pull of sin. Victory, daily victory. Romans 6, verses 1 through 7. Verse 7 talks about freed from sin because of the resurrection power of Christ. Oh, thank God for the freedom that we have in Jesus. Thank God for the freedom that we have in America that we enjoy and the privilege we have for life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And thank God for God's blessing upon our country. But as we think about what they're bombarding our innocent little children of, what gender do you want to be? The sick things that I don't want to elaborate into too much. It makes me sick at my stomach. Just the terrible erosion that's happening so quickly before our very eyes. Oh, thank God for the Spirit of God. It gives us as Christians discernment. We see it. We see things happening. We see the end times coming. And sadly, flaunting, horrible, wicked sin. Gay Pride Month all across America. Gay Pride Parade. It's a reproach before a holy God. Yes. Listen, we love the sinner, but we hate the sin. Amen.
Right.
We stand against the sin. And let's not ever get used to the wickedness and the sin. May it always bother us. Yes. May it always cause us some righteous indignation. Amen. May we always take a strong step. But we love the sinner. Ephesians 4:15 says, teach the truth in love. Oh, thank God that we are on the right track because Christ has set our feet upon the solid rock. And we are freed indeed. Oh, the reproach and the horrible, horrible, wicked, murderous agenda, taking little lives from the womb and killing them and murdering them by the thousands every day. And the pressure for doctors to take life in their own hands. Life is in the hand of God, amen. It's His right alone. The lawlessness. There are stores in our cities where people go in and rob and go a block down the street and sell the goods without any fear of punishment. Lawlessness. Revelation warns us of that. People professing themselves to be wise, they become as fools. Oh, the foolish intent of the heart of so many. And thank God for the freedom that we have in Christ, that greatest friend of all. But what are we going to do about it? What am I going to do about it? We need revival. I need personal revival. Our churches need need church-wide revivals. Our nation needs revival. 2 Corinthians 7:14 is true. It applies to us today, I believe. Wilt thou not revive us again? The psalmist said that thy people may rejoice in thee. You know, the Bible says, no good thing will he withhold from them. They'll walk uprightly. Here you are on a Sunday, on a holiday weekend at church. You're doing the right thing, amen?
Amen.
And God enables us to pray. We have the freedom to pray. We can go out on the street and pray. Just 2 weeks ago, we were able to go to Belmont Horse Track, the third leg of the big race in the spring. No, not to gamble, praise God, but to hand out gospel tracts and witness, and 12 people from our church went, and we handed out thousands of gospel tracts, had a wonderful time, and praise the Lord, on Saturdays, we've had more people coming out doing soul winning with us, and going witnessing door to door down in the streets. And it's just been a wonderful thing to see. And recently at the church, God has enabled us to baptize 6 young adults between the ages of 19 and 22 years old. Mm-hmm. Just been such a privilege, such a blessing. I'm just asking God, keep it coming, Lord, please. Don't let this stop. And the blessings are good right now. And thank God for that. And I think of my friend Russ, who just it'll be 2 years this September. His 23-year-old daughter died with an overdose. I know the heartache of that. And the Holy Spirit really touched my heart the other day when I was feeling sorry for myself about our first daughter moving to Georgia. And I thought, my friend Russ, who lost his daughter. And our daughter Amanda
went up to Becky and hugged her neck, and her and her three children, her husband, before they stepped out the door to make the travel, the drive down south. And she said, "Mom, I'm sorry." And I thought for a moment, I thought, what's she sorry for? I thank God that she's been a good girl. Sinner, yes. Imperfect, yes, but she's always tried to please God and please us. Amen. And I realized she was apologizing to her mom for leaving her. But I thank God we have her. I thank God she loves the Lord. Yes. Thank God for a praying mother who prayed the kids through all those hard years. And they haven't arrived yet, just like we haven't arrived yet. But they're in general living for Jesus. Thank God. They have Christian husbands. Miracle happened. Two of them are from Queens, New York. Two of the husbands are from Queens, New York. That boggles my mind. How could they be from Queens and be a good husband? It boggles my mind. It really does. And prayer is powerful. Yeah. Oh, let us pray. What are we going to do about our sick country? The old ship is taking on water. It's sinking. We're about to lose it. We're about to lose our freedoms. What are we going to do about it? Oh, we have to pray as never before. Let us pray fervently. Let us witness boldly. Oh, my friend, let's get out from our own protective environment. Let's extend ourselves and witness for the glory of God. I know about the shyness. I know about the withholding. If I had my way, I would live on a mountain somewhere, a stream, away from people. I don't like being around a lot of people. God put us around a lot of people. The Tampa Bay area, I don't need to tell you, is getting more and more and more people. What are we going to do about it? We need to tell them about Jesus. God has brought the mission field here. And oh, how they need the Lord. People need the Lord. Let us fervently pray. Let us witness as never before. Let us go forward. Don't get discouraged. I was just telling someone last week before we went out, going door to door in our neighborhood around the church. In the Tampa Bay area, back around 1980, every Saturday when we went out, visiting the Sunday school bus route, we would always see someone get saved or someone come to church. You always would see results. And I said, here in New York, you don't always see results every time you go out. And I believe people's hearts are harder. And I believe it's the sinner's hearts often that are harder because of less Bible influence, because of our wicked culture. But I also believe, as one preacher friend of mine, Brother Knickerbocker knows him, said to me one day, after a service, he began to weep, and he's not the type of preacher to weep. He said, "Kent, for years I've thought it was the hardness of those sinners." He said, "I realize it's the hardness of my heart, that I don't have enough compassion, that I'm not fervently praying as I should." Oh, God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we could ask or think. Amen. Thank God for the freedom we have to pray. We can still witness. We can still go out on street corner and talk to people about Jesus. We can still do what Americans do. Amen. Yes. It's being taken from us. But let us take advantage of the freedom and let us stand strong. And God can stay the judgment that's coming, the evil that's bombarding us. God can put up a standard against that. Righteousness exalteth the nation. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Amen. Oh, thank the Lord today for the privilege we have to live for Christ in a wicked world. You know, the light that shines the brightest is the light that's in the darkest area. Where sin abounds, grace is much more than abound. Yes. A preacher at our church said he was visiting Mammoth Cave National Park, visiting a missionary. He said he had a little tiny light on his wristwatch and he never thought anything of it. And when the ranger turned off all the lights in this cavern where it was completely dark, so dark you can't see your hand in front of your face, the little fish in the little stream don't have eyes, they're blind because there's no light. And he said it was so dark, but he said that little tiny insignificant light beamed like a giant lighthouse. Our lights that God has given us can shine brightly during a dark time in which we live. I remember another missionary preacher at our church from South America years ago. His father was dying in his 90s. He said, "I talked to Dad today. And he said, Dad told me goodbye, and he said, 'Son, I'm sorry, I'm not leaving you any money. I'm not leaving you any land. I have nothing to leave you.'" You know what this missionary said? I don't think I'll ever forget it. He said, "Dad, that's okay. You left us Jesus."
Amen.
Let us do all we can to leave the people around us, wherever we're at. If we're in a place called Florida that everybody in New York thinks is heaven, you know it's not heaven.
Compared to New York, it may be, but it's not heaven. There are problems everywhere.
Yeah.
Wherever it is that God puts us, let's do all we can to leave them Jesus.
Amen.
That's the answer. Let's do that. Our nation needs revival. Unless we stand, unless I stand, I'm talking to myself, unless I stand as I should, unless I pray as I should, if I look back over my ministry, if I could do one thing better, I would pray more. Oh, how we need the power of prayer. He's able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all we could ask or think. Amen. Let us pray fervently for our nation. Maybe in a few moments, as we land the plane on this message, maybe we could come forward here in a few moments and get on our knees and pray for America. It's the only hope. Our nation needs prayer. Our nation needs God's people filled with the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God indwells us. He's present with us all the time, 1 Corinthians 3:16. And as we yield ourselves to Him, He is prominent in our life. But as we yield ourselves consistently, the Bible says, walk in the Spirit so as not to fulfill the lust of the flesh. Be filled with the Spirit, Ephesians 5:18. He can be preeminent in our life. That's what America needs. Born-again Christians, whose God is their Lord, who the Spirit of God indwells and fills and is preeminent in their life. And they have the fruit of the Spirit and the boldness to tell the people, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Yes, the greatest freedom is the freedom we have in Christ. The greatest friend is Jesus Christ. My father-in-law said, Russ is my only friend. He's pretty close to truth. Right, there's Becky. There's my friend Jesus, the greatest friend of all. And I thank God for other friends. Many of you are my friends. And I thank God for you. And oh, how I miss friends that used to be here that have gone on before us. People that prayed for us. People that showed us love, kindness. But whoa, what a friend Jesus is. It's been said if you go through life and you have two true friends, you're truly a blessed individual. And someone that sticks through you, with you through thick and thin is always there. But I'll tell you, Jesus is that friend that sits closer than a brother. In John 10:10, he said, I'm come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Right after he warns us about Satan, who comes to steal, to kill, and destroy. And we see it, him doing it to our nation through leaders that are evildoers, that are following the drumbeat of the devil, not God.
That's right.
A president who says he's a certain religion, who's against abortion, and he practices it, he pushes it, he promotes it, and if I'm offending you, excuse me, I love you anyway, and I can prove to you I'm right.
Yes. Amen.
We need to stand strong. We need to pray. And God says to pray for our leaders. Sometimes, I don't know about you, but it's hard for me, but nevertheless, we need to pray for our leaders.
That's right.
God is a great God. The heart of the king is in the hand of God. God can still save people that are in strong positions that have hard hearts. God can save them.
That's right.
Let's pray. Let's do what we should as Christians. Let's do our part. Let's meet our potential for the Lord. Let's be all we can be. Oh, yes, the greatest freedom is Christ, found in Christ. Thank God for the great free nation we have. The greatest friend of all is our friend, King Jesus. Thank God for the privilege we have to know Him. America's been blessed, as we heard earlier, because of sending out missionaries. America's been blessed because we're a friend of Israel, friend to Israel.
Amen.
And I believe the devil's trying to eliminate America so that we won't be able to send missionaries.
That's right.
So that we won't be able to defend Israel.
That's right.
And there are people in leadership today that are doing their part to eliminate America. Get out of the way and let the Antichrist step in. But as for us, why don't we stay today? We're going to do all we can to stand. Even though there are problems, even though there may be weaknesses, God's grace is shown, His power is shown strong in our weakness, amen. Let's stand strong for God. Let's pray as never before. Let's be faithful to God's house. He gave His life for it. He gave His blood for it. Our greatest friend, the Lord Jesus Christ. In New York Harbor stands a lady with her torch raised to the sky. And all who see her know she stands for it. Liberty for you and I. I'm so glad to be called an American. To be named with the brave and the free. I will honor our flag and I'll trust in God and the Statue of Liberty. On lonely Golgotha stood a cross with my Lord raised to the sky. And all who kneel there live forever. All the saints can testify.
I'm so glad to be called a Christian, to be named with the ransomed and whole. As a statue liberates the citizen, so the cross liberates my soul. Oh, the cross is my statue of liberty. It was there that my soul was set free. Unashamed, I'll proclaim that old rugged cross is my statue of liberty. Amen. The greatest freedom is freedom that we have in Christ that others need. The greatest friend beyond comparison, the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior. What a wonderful God he is. Praise the Lord for his mercy to us. And then the greatest future. The greatest future. In John chapter 11, verses 25 and 26, Jesus says such words of comfort at the time of a loss of a loved one that knows Christ. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Thank God today that we have eternal life in Christ. We have an abundant life now, John 10:10, if we will just walk with him. And we have eternal life forever. Born once, die twice. Born twice, die once. And if the rapture happens, we don't even have to die once. Hallelujah. Jesus is coming again. Amen. Amen. And it looks like it's very close. I've heard it all my life. I've heard it since a little kid. My mom and dad told me I heard it in the womb that Jesus is coming again. Have I begun to doubt it? I believe it more now than I ever believed it.
Yes.
I remember years ago before I met Becky. Thank God. God delivered me. There was this lady. There was a young lady. She thought we were kind of boyfriend, girlfriend. I took her to this church at an invitation of the guy on the construction job. He had been going to this church, and he got right with God. He said, come on over to this church. We have this guest speaker, and he's a great evangelist. He's a great preacher. And he started preaching about the rapture. He got excited. This young lady from this dignified church, it was the kind of church where if anybody said amen, they would turn around and say, hark, what strange noise emits from yon visitor. And she began to sink lower and lower and lower and seeing. God used that night to help me know that wasn't the one for me. This evangelist was preaching so hard about the rapture. And he would tell the pastor, he said, pastor, you and I are going to be going up in the clouds. And I'm going to say, that's him. That's him. That's my Savior. That's the one who died for me and rose from the dead. That's Jesus. It's that real. Jesus is coming again. I believe it more now than I've ever believed it. How about you? He's coming again. It could be at any moment. Jesus is coming back. Let us be doing all we can do to serve him until we see him face to face. Oh, what a friend who gives us this guaranteed future beyond belief. People by the millions this weekend, tens of millions, have been going on vacation, relieved after the virus scare, some of that's still going on. I think as far as we Christians are concerned, let's get over it. Let's get over it. Let's get over it. Let's go on and serve God. God has not given us a spirit of fear, except for during the coronavirus. But he's given us love and power and a sound mind. Let's go on and serve God. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk upright. We have a brilliant future in the days ahead as we walk with Jesus and forever in heaven. This world is not our home. We're just passing through. It's all temporary. It's all going on. It's passing. I remember ending a service some years ago and the Lord just laid on my heart, Psalm 84:6. No good thing will he withhold from them that walk uprightly. And I said to the people, I said, do you believe that? And it was almost the Spirit of God turned the question in my heart. Son, do you believe it? A couple days later, I got a phone call. And it was my friend Russ. And he said, for my 49th birthday, I'm giving you a brand new pickup truck. And I said, I got to call you back. I thought it was a dream. I pinched myself calling him back. It was real. He gave me a brand new pickup. We had just had one of our daughters married. It was the first time in since we had children, that we could take everybody in a 5-passenger vehicle, because we had 6 before, and I'd always wanted a pickup truck. Christian, that's just a small illustration that God delights in helping his children. He wants to help us. We have a brilliant future in the days ahead as we serve him, no matter how bad things get, and we hope they get better, but we have a brilliant future in heaven. Are you ready? in one of our wars, there was an officer who had been witness to. He was under conviction of the Spirit of God. He was considering coming to know Christ. Just 2 weeks ago, the lady that received a gospel tract during this winter at our church has been coming sporadically. She's been going back and forth between our church and a false religion church. She asked her priest, should I go to that Baptist church? Guess what the priest said? No way, don't go to that church. But she has, and the Spirit of God's been bringing her. And 2 weeks ago, my wife and I sat down with her after everything was over, a young lady. And before this day, she had brought a young mother with four children. She had brought a Jewish 90-year-old Korean War veteran to church before she came to know Christ 2 weeks ago. And it was such a wonderful thing to know, because someone gave her a gospel tract out on a street. She started coming to church, and now she knows Christ. Thank the Lord for that. God's at work.
Good.
And God does wonderful things, and a lot of you could give testimonies of that today. As we were driving down to Florida, we hit traffic the whole way. People were traveling all around. A lot of people, I think, were driving because they wanted to avoid all the plane mishaps and the layovers and the delayed flights. And so out in rural areas of Virginia, North and South Carolina, Georgia, even Florida, there was just bumper to bumper traffic. Stop and go, stop and go, stop and go. We've made this trip dozens of times, usually driving, sometimes flying, and it took more than twice as long as ever before to get down here. But it gave my wife and I a lot of time to talk. She got me a little bit straightened out, not completely. I have some Native American, not enough to avoid any taxes. I wish it were a little bit more so I could avoid taxes, but my wife said, that's why you go on the warpath sometimes, because you have Native American, but it was just amazing, all the traffic, and we heard about all the people traveling on planes, or having layovers, some people in our church, and different things like that. But we're traveling to a wonderful place. We always look forward to coming home to Florida and Fowler Avenue Baptist Church. This is home. And I've asked God to remove my homesickness there in New York many times. And in the wintertime, some of you call and say, Kent, it's 85 degrees here. Knowing it's 20 below zero, wind chill, fagger, ice, and snow. How is it there? People like to rub in when they're in better weather conditions than others. And I've fought homesickness in the wintertime, and I've never gotten over it. But God has always kept us there. And a lot of times, because of a faithful wife, there have been times I wanted to quit. You can't quit. God's called you here. Thank God for good Christian churches, for Christian friends, for Christian wives. Thank God. Most of us men are far below. Well, we don't deserve the wife God's given us. Amen.
Amen.
You can say amen. And I'm just trying to finish here, but there was a military officer. He was fighting, really, with the Spirit of God. There was a young 18-year-old soldier that was shot fatally. And he walked over to this man's side, and this officer held his hand knowing he was dying. Because he had heard about the gospel and someone had witnessed to him, he knew he was dying. He said, son, are you prepared for eternity? Even though he wasn't a Christian. And he knew enough about the gospel to tell him. He said, would you receive Jesus? And he smiled, he nodded his head, and he died. And this officer later said at that very instant, God saved me. And the question is today, are you saved? I believe that the vast majority of us here today are saved, but perhaps there's one here or more that have never truly been born again. Oh, don't go another day without knowing Jesus. Life is uncertain. More than you need anything else, you need Christ. God did the complicated part. Our part is so simple, just to receive that wonderful gift, to turn from sin and trust Jesus. Believe in your heart on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. That he died for you, that he rose again from the dead. And Christian, today, the question for you is a question that every preacher should ask themselves. Are you surrendered to the Lord? One of the greatest Christians ever lived, right in the middle of 1 Corinthians 15:31, penned the words, I die daily. He's talking about that old struggle between the sinful nature and the Spirit of God. Are you surrendered today? You say, well, I was yesterday. I was a week ago. I was a year ago. How about right now? You need to surrender yourself afresh. Would you join me in just a moment? A special time of prayer. Could we come here forward in just a moment and bow down and pray for our nation? America needs us praying. You say, well, we need this politician. I'm all for good politicians. We need this leader. We need this president. They are not the answer. God is the answer.
That's right.
And we have the answer. Let's pray together. Father, I pray that you would just bless this simple message to our heart. God, help me with your power to do what I can for our nation, to pray, to witness, to stand the word, to be faithful to your church, to be faithful to the family of God. I pray the same for my friends today. With heads bowed and eyes closed, no one look around. You're here today and you say, preacher, I'm here today and I'm like that young soldier that was dying. I need Jesus. I'm not dying. You may be healthy as a horse, but you know you need Jesus. You slip up your hand, I might pray for you. Is there one like that? Don't be ashamed. Don't let Satan play with your head. You follow what God is telling you to do. You say, I need the Lord. I need Christ. He says, truly, truly, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that hears my word and believes on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death into life. But those that believe not are condemned already, condemned to hell. You're lost. You need Christ. Say, pray for me. I need the Lord. You're here today and you say, I'm so glad that I'm saved. I'm so glad I'm an American. And today I want to be fully surrendered to my Lord. I want to surrender my life afresh, perhaps for the very first time to God. Romans 12, 1 and 2, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is a good and acceptable and perfect will of God. You'd say, I just want to surrender myself to the Lord for the sake of my Lord, for the sake of my nation. If that's you, would you slip up your hand? As we pause just for a moment. Dear Father in heaven, I pray you'd have your wonderful will and your way in our life. Thank you for the word of God. We thank you for our greatest friend, Jesus. We thank you for the great freedom that we have in this country and the freedom we have as born-again Christians. And we thank you, Lord, for our great future. Lord, may we be grateful every day. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
I would like to give you a chance to take a stand for the Lord if you'd like to do it. Anyone here like to take a stand? Just stand up and say, I'm trusting Jesus Christ as my Savior today. Would you like to stand and make that statement by standing? Hey, today, I'm standing because today is the day I've asked Jesus to be my personal Savior. All of us could stand and say, hey, I want revival in my heart. I want to be what God wants me to be. As we do always at the end of a service, not only speaking to the people here that are present, making sure that you know Christ is your personal Savior, not just knowing about him, but you know the time and the place where you ask him to come into your heart and save you. If you haven't done that, you can do it today. And those who are watching on video land, I know you come from different backgrounds, different religions, but today we're asking you not to trust religion. Religion is dangerous. Religion is deadly. Religion will send you to hell without Christ. You need to say, I'm trusting Jesus. You're going to say, Lord Jesus, I believe you died on that cross and shed your blood. And the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses from all sin. Lord Jesus, come into my heart and save me. I'm not trusting religion. I'm not trusting the preacher or the pope. I'm not trusting baptism. I'm trusting Jesus. He's the one who died. He's the one that shed his blood. He conquered death, hell, and the grave. Lord Jesus, come into my heart and save me right now. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for me. Thank you for being raised the third day. Thank you, Jesus, for coming into my heart. Now, Father, help us who know Christ as our Savior to be the ambassadors and witnesses you'd have us to be. As we leave this place, may we go forth and be what you want us to be for Jesus. Thank you, Father, for this service, for the preaching of your word, speaking to our hearts. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.